I would like to start this morning by reading James, the first chapter and the 8th verse. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Folks, the question is this morning, with all the garbage going on in the mass media these days, are we as Christians becoming double-minded believers? Good morning, folks. I'm Troy Wilson. If this is your first worship service with us, welcome. If you have already become a part of our 10 minutes of worship at 10 a.m. on Sundays, welcome back. Glad to have you. In doing my preparation for today's message, I came across an interesting article written by Dan Dalziel, a Christian Post contributor. The article is entitled, Seven Characteristics of a Double-Minded Believer. Now, I realize we see a lot of writings these days which play on the title of a book written by Stephen Covey, The Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. But I must say, Dan Dalziel makes some very good points, and I would like to share them with you this morning. Let me quickly lay the foundation for the seven. A double-minded believer is someone who's constantly living in a state of compromise. Half of a person lives for God, while the other half lives for their simple carnal desires, which are their desires of the flesh. Hence, they are double-minded. As you consider whether or not that experience describes your current situation, here are the seven characteristics of a double-minded believer. Number one, they are two major influences which fuel your thought life. A double-minded Christian is always being torn in two different directions. He has a relationship with Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior, but he also has a relationship with a particular sinful obsession. It is a mental obsession, a distraction, and it may even have a physical aspect. But it's a miserable way to live, folks. It's a miserable way to attempt a Christian life. Number two, you have a history with both of your major influences. No Christian becomes double-minded overnight. It takes some time to develop an unrelenting desire to pursue a particular course. But make no mistake about it, history has a way of repeating itself. Until we part ways with that thing which is stabbing at Jesus Christ all the time, we will continually find ourselves in a state, listen to me, of inner turmoil. Even if you have walked with the Lord for years, a double-minded life will circumvent much of the good which the Holy Spirit wants to work in you and through you. What every believer desperately needs is to fully surrender their heart and mind to the Lord. Number three, you find yourself compromising your thought life in one primary area. Satan has been in his craft for many centuries, and just as he knew what triggers to employ with Adam and Eve, he has discovered a variety of enticements that are intended to lead believers to become double-minded. Satan hates to see believers fully surrender to the Lord. The devil knows from past experience that when Christians are fully surrendered, God works even more miracles in the lives of his people. Jesus Christ has never compromised, not even one time. The same cannot be said about us, folks. Our challenge as sinful human beings is to say no to sin and yes to righteous living. It is not like this challenge only confronts us once or twice a week. The temptation for compromise are going on around us all the time. Number four, you are led by the Holy Spirit except when that other issue is driving your thinking. The Spirit-led Christian is not giving in to compromise. Instead, he or she is focused, filled, and flowing in the living water of the Holy Spirit. Isn't that a wonderful way to go through life? It provides, listen to me, it provides peace, power, and purpose. Say that. It provides peace, power, and purpose. Sin, on the other hand, increases the desire to give in to temptation again and again. You never get enough of sin. And so you end up double-minded, at least until you repent and come clean before the Lord and His cross. Number five, you only experience real peace in your heart when your mind is under God's control. There's no peace for a believer who is going against the convictions of the Holy Spirit. You feel out of control. You feel pulled in the direction of your obsession rather than gently led down the flowing river of God's grace and peace. Most of us who have known the Lord for a while have come to experience the vast difference between the peace God provides and the turmoil of our sinful desires. They are truly in conflict with one another, and it's a battle that doesn't stop until our soul leaves our body at the point of physical death. At that moment, we will be immediately ushered into heaven. Number six, you find yourself giving in to old habits very easily. A double-minded believer finds it next to impossible to stay away from the danger zone. He or she moves quickly in that direction at the slightest impulse. The longer a person refrains from a bad habit, the easier it is to stay away from it. But the more you cut corners, the more you find yourself locked into a double-minded quagmire, listen, of your own making. As we read at the beginning, God's word tells us a double-minded man is unstable in all that he does. No wonder old habits seem to hang on indefinitely in the life of a double-minded believer. Those old habits are simply the fruit of an unstable heart and mind. Number seven and the last one. You would love to only be drawn to the things of God. Deep within the soul of every believer is the desire to fully live for God. That desire was planted inside of us when we were converted through faith in Jesus Christ. At that moment, the Holy Spirit took up residence within our body. We began to experience the righteous desire to do things God's way. That desire will always be there within the soul of every Christian, even if you are double-minded. But the only way to experience the joy and peace God intends for us is to get back to a single-minded approach of Christian living. Somebody say amen. You know, just like when you first came to know Jesus Christ, by His grace, you can get back there. After all, it was only by His grace which brought you into this relationship in the first place. Amen. Folks, I would like to end with this one last sentence, and I realize it kind of deviates from today's message. But I really feel like it's time we get serious and excited about the return of Jesus Christ. I don't think it's going to be that long. Let us pray. Father, we realize we are living in a time of double-minded acceptance, where many have become Christian chameleons, quickly adapting to our current surroundings and failing to adhere to Your word no matter what the circumstance. Father, may we all come to realize through this sharing of Your word that Your Son, Jesus Christ, is the way, not just the way, but the only way. Father, we ask Your guidance and protection to be upon us until we meet again. In Jesus' name, we ask these things. Amen.